Welcome to Top Advisor Marketing, where you will learn how to become a prolific online influencer, attract more ideal clients, and grow your practice. Brought to you by Top Advisor Podcasting, a done-for-you podcasting solution built just for trusted advisors. And now, your co-hosts of Top Advisor Marketing, Kirk Lowe and Matt Halloran.
Hello and welcome to episode number 67, How to Overcome Adversity in Your Practice with Dr. Jack Singer. Now, this is the second or third time we've had Dr. Jack on the podcast, and we bring him back often just because he really is truly an expert, and this is the sort of stuff that's so much fun for us to sit down and pick Dr. Jack's brain. And today's really interesting to me because we're going to talk about how to overcome adversity in your practice. And I don't know how many advisors realize the level of adversity they have in their practice. So, Dr. Jack, what's the number one form of adversity that most advisors must overcome to be successful in their practice?
Well, Matt, this is a really key question because, as you mentioned, most advisors unconsciously or subconsciously deal with adversity without labeling it, and they wonder why they're not as successful as they hope to be. We find that the number one source of adversity in a practice is an advisor having what we call an imposter fear. And an imposter fear is the fear that maybe he or she is not really as good as everyone thinks they are, including their clients, and it's only a matter of time before they're found out, and then that's going to be an awful experience. So if we wanted to use a poker analogy, it's almost like your clients, your colleagues, your mentors, your coaches all think that you're a royal flush, but inside your head, secretly, you feel like a pair of threes. And it's only a matter of time before you'll be found out because you're going to make mistakes.
Now, Dr. Jack, haven't you had this same issue with high-performing athletes?
Oh, absolutely. And in fact, everything I do with financial advisors, Matt, is a metaphor of what I've done with high-performing athletes. In fact, I had two Olympic athletes in the recent Olympics that I've been working with. So it's true that that many athletes begin to wonder inside, is everyone's opinion of me better than the way I really think it is? And how am I going to keep them from finding out that I'm not really as good as they think I am? That alone, you can imagine, takes their mind in a direction that detracts them from what they need to be doing to be champions.
You've written about the internal critic. Tell me about how that determines success or failure in business life.
Well, everybody has this little voice inside their head that I call the internal critic. And unfortunately, the research shows that about 87% of the time that voice has negative messages that we allow to continue. Messages like, what if? Anything followed by what if, Matt, is usually some kind of negative, like what if I can't do this? What if I'm found out? What if I make a mistake? Other internal critic negative toxic messages are things like, I hope I don't, or I don't know if I can. Or so if we use an athletic analogy again, using the word don't is a misnomer. So let's say you take a golfer and the golfer is facing a water hazard and the golfer says to him or herself, don't hit it in the water. They have now increased the probability that they will hit it in the water dramatically, because the subconscious mind ignores negative words. So if you say, don't hit it in the water, you've just told yourself, hit it in the water. If you say, I hope I don't hit it in the water, it hears, I hope I hit it in the water. So people don't realize that, and they're constantly saying, well, I told myself not to do it. How come I did it? So that's a problem with the internal critic. And in terms of where this started, somebody named Shad Helmstetter, a professor, did a lot of research on this and discovered that it starts in early childhood with messages from well-meaning but misinformed parents and other authority figures, messages like, you know, maybe you shouldn't try out for the team. I've seen some of the other people. They're much more athletic than you are. I don't want you to be embarrassed. Or you said you want to be in the homecoming queen finale. Well, you know, I saw some of the other people there. Maybe you should avoid that. So parents who think they're helping their children are actually building up a funnel of negative self-defeating thoughts and non-risk behavior. This is what leads to the internal critic.
You have a formula to help advisors and your clients overcome this. How does it work and what is that formula?
The formula is that your performance at any time, whether it's working with clients, working on developing yourself and your skills, building your practice, whatever performance is to you, always equals your talent plus your experience. And now there's a giant minus sign. minus internal distractions. And the number one internal distraction is that internal critic. So the larger the distractions, the more often you're giving yourself negative, self-defeating, toxic comments to yourself, the less your performance will actually reflect your true talent.
Now, you have a 7-step mental toughness routine to overcome any adversity that only takes a few minutes each day. What is that?
Okay. Well, this is it really, you can do this in 5 or 10 minutes. And if you practice it enough, it'll happen automatically while you're driving in the car or anywhere else. So mental toughness, Matt, is really all about, what do I do to overcome adversity when that hits me? Or do I just accept it and then deal with the consequences? So let's take a typical adverse situation that an advisor may face. He or she gets a notice from the assistant that a certain client is on the phone and sounds angry. Now, the advisor frequently will either avoid that phone call or they'll give themselves a message that I don't want to deal with this person. He's going to complain about the market again. We've been through this 50 times. I can't control the market. I keep telling him I've prepared your portfolio for events like this, but he calls me up expecting that I should have some magic potion here to fix it. I don't want to deal with that person. Or I'm going to leave the office or something more dramatic than that. Now, that would be an example of where mental toughness needs to come into play. So the first thing in mental toughness is recognizing the trigger thoughts that set it off. So if you're feeling anxious, when you notice you have a negative emotion like anxiety, anger, frustration, unhappiness, depression, whatever it may be, step number one is, what was the triggering thought that set this emotion off? Because every single emotion people have, Matt, is always caused by a reaction to an event, not the event. So the event of the advisor's secretary saying so-and-so is on the phone is a neutral event. But what you say to yourself in response to that is not neutral. That determines whether you're going to have a reaction or not emotionally. So you follow that so far?
Absolutely.
All right. So the reaction to the event is the triggering thing. So the reaction is, oh yeah, I heard that Mr. Jones is on the call. And I said to myself, what if he starts yelling at me about the market again? I don't want to deal with this today. So that's the triggering thought. So A, you recognize the triggering thought. If you're in a place to write it down, that's even better, because as you keep a list of these triggering thoughts, you'll become familiar with when they happen again and be able to stop them quicker. Step number one is, I have to stop this thought dead in its tracks. Don't even let it complete. So the thought of, what if Mr. Jones... I now snap a rubber band that I'm wearing on my wrist. We call it a number 64 rubber band here in the States. It's the kind of rubber band that we get in the mail all the time. You can buy it in any store. It's a fat rubber band that sits loosely. And if you don't have a rubber band, you can slap your thigh or do anything to get your attention to stop the silly thinking. That's the first thing you have to do after you recognize the trigger thought. Once you've succeeded in stopping it, which may take several snaps or slapping because these are habits that want to keep coming in. You've been thinking that thought forever. It wants to keep creeping in. You have to condition your mind to stop it by giving yourself some pain every time it feels it. The next step is to take a couple of deep, relaxing breaths through your diaphragm. This is the most relaxing kind of breathing we know. It's the kind of breathing that professional musicians and singers use all the time. And the best way to force yourself to do that is to breathe in deeply through your nose to the count of 4, hold it for another 4 seconds, then a big exhale out your mouth to the count of 7 so that you get it all out. So that's forcing you to breathe in deeply. And the way you know if you're doing this correctly is if you fold your hands over your stomach, when you breathe in, your stomach should be pushing out. When you breathe out, your stomach should be coming back in again. Most people don't breathe that way naturally. And if they hold their hands over their stomach, they find their hands don't move. What's moving is their shoulders and their chest. And that's shallow breathing, which increases the likelihood of anxiety. So in general, you need to teach yourself to breathe through your diaphragm. And that can be done by while you're watching TV or anything, just practicing. So once you've accomplished that step and you've taken a nice breath and you've breathed in relaxing breaths so that you're calming down, the next step is to give yourself a remembrance of the most powerful day you can remember in your life as an advisor. The most successful day, was it a day in which some prospect you were after really resonated with you and said, I want to do business with you? Was it a day where you gave a seminar and several people rewarded you afterward and said, this is very valuable. Maybe I'll send my funds to your practice now. Whatever it was, you need to have a video in your mind as if you're replaying that immediately in every aspect that you can remember, which means what was the situation? What was the time of day? What was the room like that you were doing this in? Or if it was outdoors, what was happening? Everything you can remember in as much detail. Now, why do we do this? Because our minds tend to go back to failures all the time. Things where we were embarrassed or mortified or upset. And we need to get out of that kind of thinking and recall the positive things that have happened to us in life. So this video in your mind, which you can go to anytime, whether you're practicing this or not, will help you recall successes and give you the encouragement that you can repeat these successes. You have to let go of negatives, let go of all of the toxic things that have happened, and nourish your mind with remembering all of the positive things. The next step is what we call a performance statement. A performance statement is, if it was an athletic metaphor, if you were about to engage in the most important game of your life and the best coach you ever had only had 30 seconds to remind you of some things to keep aware of, what would he or she say? So think about it as an advisor. If you're about to engage in a very important meeting or seminar that you're producing, or a meeting with a client that you really want to land because it's a big deal, what would your mentor or whoever you respected the most in your training, what would he in 30 seconds tell you to do? So for some advisors, they've written these things down in workshops that I've done. They've written things down like, I realize that what I'm going to do with my next client is I'm going to engage my listening skills, which are something that I practice diligently, so that before I try to sell this client on a product or a service, I need to listen to where the pain is coming from, what keeps them up at night, what do they really need. And once I understand that, then I can identify with them and we're on the same page where I can help them find solutions. So that's a performance statement that will lead to success for me rather than selling them on myself. It's all about them, not about me. And once you've done the performance statement, the next thing is an identity statement. So what is an identity statement? An identity statement is putting yourself in the position of being the best that you ever envisioned you could be. What would be your goal in being the best you could ever envision yourself to be? And think about it as if you've already accomplished it. So an advisor might say, I'm so proud to be invited to join the $1 million roundtable. I'm so thrilled that they appreciate the hard work that I put in. I am the hardest worker in my office. I will continue to be the hardest worker, and I will continue to be recognized for my work ethic and my success. So even if you're not achieving it yet, you think about this as if you've already accomplished it. This tricks the subconscious mind into wanting to do that because you're believing it every day. And then once you've done those things, the seventh step is you anchor this with another deep, relaxing breath like you did before. So that, in short, is the seven-step mental toughness routine. Now, I recognize that many of your listeners probably haven't written this down carefully. So for your listeners, I would be happy to send them this seven-step. All they have to do is email me. And is it okay if I give you my email address right
Absolutely.
Now? Absolutely. Okay, they just have to email me at drjack@advisingtheadvisors.com. And if they actually go to that website, www.advisingtheadvisors.com, they'll see where they can click onto a free Get My 7-Step Mental Toughness Routine.
And Dr. Jack, we'll make sure that we get that in the speaker notes. Now, other things that you've written about talk about focusing on the process rather than the outcome. What is the motivation behind that?
Okay, let's start with the athletes again. If an athlete is worried about whether they're going to win or not, or how the event is going to turn out, then they're not focused on what they need to do to win. You see, you have a choice. You could, like a golfer, for example, a golfer says, I need to score 71 to keep the lead today. And they hear other people cheering on other holes from golfers, or they look at a leaderboard and they start worrying about where their performance is. They have a high likelihood of not performing their best doing that because they're not focused on the process. The process, or in Canada, you say the process of doing well, is really, what do I need to do to be my best at this moment? How do I bring my A game to this at this moment? So for the golfer, it's where do I put my feet? When do I breathe? What is my pre-shot routine? And where am I going to concentrate my target? That's where you need to be focused on, not what my score is going to be. For the financial advisor, the outcome is, am I going to land this deal? Am I going to get this client? If you're so worried about that, you will not be concentrating on the process it takes to get there, which is listen, use Dr. Jack's active empathic listening technique. Make sure you don't sell anything until you understand everything about the client. Find out the commonalities you have with the client. Do you go to the same church? Do you follow the same athletic teams? What can you find in common that will make that person trust you and embrace you instead of being like every other advisor who's tried to sell them services? This is the process of being an advisor as opposed to focusing on the outcome and worrying about whether you're going to be successful or not.
We work with advisors a lot, talking to them about making sure that they have a very good process, and that process is something that they use in their sales system, because processes are what really differentiate you from the other advisor down the street, not an outcome. Is that a fair statement?
Yes, it is. It is the process, because how you used a great term, how is an advisor going to differentiate him or herself from the tremendous competition they have? Other people refer people to other advisors because they're their friends. They have all kinds of reasons. How do you differentiate yourself? Well, my advisor, for example, did not try to sell himself on his services at all. My advisor invited me to come to a client meeting he was having. And at the client meeting, I sold myself because I heard that this advisor, A, is very smart, B, is talking about the successes that they've had because of the strategies that he implements and the core values that he always abides by, regardless of what the market is doing. And at the end, he never said, would you like to sign up with me? He just said, thank you for coming. When I said, you know, I'd really like to talk to you more about putting my assets in your company, he said, well, let's set a time for that. We'll discuss what your needs are and make sure they match with what I have to offer. So that's the kind of advisor who makes it somewhat challenging, wants to make sure that it's the right fit, doesn't say, oh, great, I'm going to get another client.
So let's talk about, well, deeper, if you don't mind, about self-hypnosis, because for those listeners who aren't aware, a lot of what Dr. Jack was just talking about with the rubber band, the self-talk, the negative self-talk, a lot of that really is self-hypnosis. So Dr. Jack, would you mind diving into self-hypnosis and how powerful that is to change behavior?
Yes. Well, everybody has hypnotized themselves without defining it as hypnosis. Here are some examples. You're in high school and you're sitting in class and it's a wonderful spring day and you're near a window and you look out the window and you're looking at a squirrel or some birds. And before you know it, the bell goes off. The class is over. You can't believe it. Where did the time go? You put yourself in a hypnotic state and blocked everything else out. Or you're reading something you're very interested in, or watching something on TV you're very interested in. Someone's trying to get your attention and they finally have to shout to get your attention because you're absorbed in it. That's self-hypnosis. So we hypnotize ourselves all the time by just focusing our concentration and blocking out distractions. The cool thing about hypnosis is you can teach yourself to use self-hypnosis for anything. You can use it as an athlete and use it to help yourself to avoid distractions and stay zoned in and focused on the goal in mind. Or you can do it as a financial advisor, focusing on goals and practicing self-hypnosis. And I also have, you know, on my website, some practice hypnotic techniques and things like that. I actually make hypnotic recordings for advisors to use, called Developing the Mindset of a Champion Advisor, to use to develop self-hypnosis. But we do this all the time. And the unfortunate thing is most of our self-hypnosis is negative, self-defeating. I don't think I can do this. I'm not going to take a chance. And this comes from something that I call, Matt, iceberg belief systems that we have. They're called iceberg beliefs because only a little of it is we're aware of consciously. Most of it's below the surface. So iceberg beliefs are things that we've been taught by parents, teachers, maybe other important people in our lives. Again, well-meaning people who think they're helping us, but in the long run, they're really hurting us. Examples of iceberg beliefs: don't take risks, fly under the radar, don't become noticed, avoid confrontations at all costs. Now, someone who avoids confrontations at all costs will not assert themselves in places where they need to be assertive, and they'll be in the shadows all the time. They will not differentiate themselves from other people. It's important to have everybody like you is another unfortunate. Like, I need to do everything to please people, even if I hurt myself in the process. So those are examples of iceberg beliefs that people have grown up with without recognizing that they have those belief systems. And then they wonder why they're not as accomplished as the person next to them who perhaps has the same education, the same training, but yet their performance is much better. It's the iceberg beliefs that are holding them back. That's the adversity that we need to recognize and overcome.
So with that, self-talk, and you've talked about self-talk already today, but words really have a substantial amount of power. I was just talking to my kids, Dr. Jack. One of my sons said to me, "Dad, I'm really bad at math." And I said, "Dude, don't say that, because every time you say that, you're convincing yourself that you are bad at math." Can you just spend, and we'll wrap up the podcast with this today, could you give us some examples of some of this positive self-talk, how to change the way that you say things as an advisor that our clients, our listeners can take away and say, okay, I'm going to write that down on a 3x5 card. I'm going to put it on a sticky note on my desk. I'm going to say this to myself before I have an important meeting. What sort of advice would you give, Dr. Jack?
Perfect. Perfect example. And by the way, what did you tell your son to do instead?
I told him to say, "I like math."
Now, that may not work because inside he doesn't believe it.
Well, yeah, okay. Okay, so tell me what I should have said.
Here's something better. Math is challenging for me right now, but I'll learn how to overcome that challenge.
Oh.
Okay?
Sure.
So he's not changing it to something he doesn't believe in, because then it doesn't work. So it's like if somebody says, "I'm not going to hit the ball into the water," but inside they are afraid they really are, then they've not done themselves any favors.
Okay? Gotcha.
But if they said to themselves, "I'm going to aim at a target past the water, and I've done this 100 times before, so I'm going to do it again," they have a high probability of accomplishing that. So with an advisor, here's the situation. You find yourself giving yourself some negative self-defeating self-talk. For example, "I don't know if I can ever please this client, and he's probably going to fire me." Okay, that would be something that advisors say to themselves all the time. So the first thing I say is ask yourself a list of several questions. A, do I have any evidence to support that this client is going to fire me? What is the probability that the client's going to fire me? Has the client ever called me upset before, and did he fire me? Okay, so start thinking rationally about this. B, yes, this is a challenging client. Even if the worst case scenario took place that he wants to fire me, is that awful? Maybe I'd be giving myself a gift to get this person off my back. In fact, in my book, Matt, chapter 7 in my book is the 10 most toxic personality types that advisors have in their practices and how to get rid of them, because they'll be giving themselves the best birthday gift in the world if they get rid of one each birthday. Okay, so you have to say, even if the worst case scenario, which is highly unlikely to happen, even if it happened, is that really the end of the world for me? So with your son, "I hate math." Okay, if he said to himself, "Is there any possibility I could learn to appreciate math more?" Well, yeah, I suppose if I didn't have such a negative attitude, maybe I could be more open to it. Maybe I'm just afraid of math. Instead of "I hate math," "I'm afraid of math." Why am I afraid of math? Because I don't do well in it. Why don't I do well in it? Because I'm afraid and it's holding me back. I need to go into it with a different attitude. I need to get help from a teacher who cares about me and has belief that I can do well in it. There's no such thing as "I hate math." I'm challenged by it, but that's a temporary scenario.
Gotcha. I will absolutely do that when he gets home today. See, good. Everybody, all you have to do is give Dr. Jack a call. And now if I might be speaking out of turn here. I apologize if I am, but if can't people sign up for a free consult with you?
Yes. I mentioned before that your listeners, if they tell me that they heard me on your podcast, I will give them a free 15 or 20 minute phone consultation. Let me give the number. 949 area code. This is on the East Coast of America. 949-481-5660. The other thing that I'd like to mention that I don't think I ever mentioned to you before because it's hot off the presses is I have an e-course
Oh.
that covers how an advisor can develop the mindset of a champion. It's a 6-module e-course that they can take at their own pace as many times as they want for one fee. And I will give your listeners a $200 discount, just for your listeners, to take that course. And the best part is not the discount. The best part is they get 12 continuing education credits that they can use for their continuing education at the end of the year. So the best way to find out about that is to go to that website, which is www.developthemindsetofachampion.com, or call me and I'll go over it with them.
Fantastic.
They can take that at their own leisure. They can take it as many times as they want. It's got everything that my book, the Financial Advisor's Ultimate Stress Mastery Guide, has in it and more, and they'll learn everything they ever need to learn on how to overcome adversity and become the best advisor they can be.
And Dr. Jack, we'll make sure that we have all of that stuff in the show notes. Thank you for your time today.
It's my pleasure as always. And you know what's really great about talking to you is you really listen to the answers. You know, many people who interview me, they're looking at the next question. They're not even listening. But you follow up on what I say. You go off on tangents that make a lot of sense. You're a very impressive man, Matt. I really appreciate it.
Well, Dr. Jack, I absolutely love having you on the show, and I absolutely love having the opportunity to ask you questions. So thank you very much for your time.
Always. Anytime. Thank you.
Yep. And this was episode number 67, How to Overcome Adversity in Your Practice. Make sure you check out Dr. Jack's website and make sure that you write down those phone numbers, which we'll make sure are in the show notes. For Dr. Jack and Kirk Lowe and all of us here at Top Advisor Marketing, thank you very much. If you haven't subscribed to the podcast below, make sure you click that subscribe now button. And that way, every time we come out with a new podcast like this, it'll show up on your listening device. With that, thank you very much. And we'll see you on the other side of the mic very soon.
Are you ready to change the way you communicate with your clients? Are you tired of being the best-kept secret in your area? Learn how to become a prolific online influencer, attract more ideal clients, and grow your business. Contact us today and see what the power of podcasting can do for your business. Click on the Contact Us link on our website at topadvisormarketing.com and set up a call to learn more. Follow us on LinkedIn and Facebook for more updates and information.